Welcome to this beautiful evening in this beautiful Congress. The next talk is very interesting talk. It's actually, we'll go tackle some words, quality, quantity, the army, actually using an army to have some balance in a way, not, I can actually just say, what can an army do if the army was ethically put into action, let's say. So, Mr. constantdull will introduce the talk for us today, and please welcome him with a warm applause.
So, first of all, thank you very much for joining. It's a great privilege and honor to speak in this context of the great CCC. I'm genuinely more nervous than I would normally be. So anyway, forgive me if I stutter or something, but like, hopefully I'm not because I drank some beer. So I built an army. This one much is true, and it's nice because we're talking about crypto wars and about losing the war, and we talk about like all this kind of stuff, and we have all these war analogies. So I thought it's also kind of fitting to present an army to you, but like I will actually explain to you how I got there. So some people might know me from works like these, which is which doesn't have sound, I think it did originally, but anyway, this is the revolving internet. I made it in 2010, so making jokes of like pre-existing web content, which is a company called Google, which a lot of people seem to keep talking about, and I twisted it around. So I made the internet revolve, just like the world rotates, I guess. Yeah, so, and then I made this other thing, which is called the death of the URL, because the URLs died, and this is one of the first things where it's actually a triple X domain name, which was the first attempt to organize all the URLs so it would be easier to block on porn content. But then I just, you see what happens, you know, so that's happening. So I basically changed the title. Normally the referrer is, like, the referrer is actually in the title bar as a URL, but now the title is actually in the page, and you get it. Yeah, so that's, or I would like encrypt a treasure map, and this treasure map is actually weirdly enough sold for like a lot of money in New York on an auction house, just because it points to another treasure on Treasure Island, where the fictive or maybe real treasure of Lima is buried, and now there's an actual exhibition buried. I started a company recently, Dull Tech, because I want technology to be more dull. Because I think technology is like perceived to be exciting while it's not. It should just be dull as fuck as it is. This is actually, I also retrieved the very first image that was ever photoshopped, which I was quite happy about finding. And then I decided to write I didn't put a timer. So anyway, I'll see notes. I wrote a letter to her, to the protagonist in the picture, Jennifer. And I'll read you the letter right now. Dear Jennifer, sometime in 1988, you were sitting on a beach in Bor Bor looking at Opoa Island, enjoying a holiday with a very serious boyfriend. The serious boyfriend, John, took a photograph of you sitting on the beach, not wearing your bikini top. John later became your husband and father to your children, Sarah, Lisa, Alex, and Jane. John, if you're watching this, hi. This photograph of a beautiful moment in your personal history has also become a part of my history and that of many other people. It has even shaped our outlooks on the world at large. John's image of you became the very first photograph to be publicly altered by the most influential image manipulation program ever. Of course, this is why I know the names of your children, and this is also why I know you're trying to do cool things, trying to get a .green top-level domain name. Anyway, personally, I believe that the importance of the domain name has been reduced to a nostalgic poetic value, but that doesn't matter now. I still wonder if you felt the world change there on that beach, the fact that reality would be more moldable, that normal people could change their history, brighten up their past, and put twirl effects on their faces. That holiday image became the very first photograph publicly manipulated in Photoshop, and your intimate beach moment became the reality for several potential clients to play with. Two Jennifers, no Jennifer, less clouds, etc. And in essence, it was the very first Photoshop meme. But now the image is nowhere to be found online. Did John ask you if he could use this particular image? Did you enjoy seeing yourself on the screen as much as he did? Did you ever think you would be the muse that would inspire so much contemporary image making? Did you ever print out the image yourself? Would you be willing to share the image with me, and if so, with the other people to whom it took on such an unexpected significance? Shouldn't the Smithsonian or any other large institution have the negative of that image, not to mention digital backups of its endless variations? All these questions have made me decide to redistribute the image, Jennifer in Paradise, as well as I can, somewhat as an artist, somewhat as a digital archaeologist, restoring what few traces of it I could find, restoring the image from what was available to everyone in the somewhat public space of the internet. It was sad to realize this blurry screen grab was the closest I could get to the image, but beautiful at the same time. How often do you find an important image that is not online in several different sizes already? This beautiful artifact of software development has become an artwork in this way, in which you, or at least your depiction, play a central part in a body of work that has become very dear to me, a faint, blurry, pixelated focal point, a work that celebrates the time that you were young and the world was young, as it still naively believed in the authenticity of the photograph. Sometimes, when I'm anxious about the future of our surveilled, computer-mediated world, when I worry about cultural imperialism and the politics behind software design, I imagine myself traveling back in time, just like the Terminator, to that important moment in technological world history, there on that beach in Bora Bora, and just sit there with you, watching the tide roll away. Sincerely, Constant Dullard. So, Jennifer never responded. Thank you. But the cool thing was, so this was basically an anecdote in Adobe's history, right? So there was like some talk about this picture, but I couldn't find it online. And it was in a video, which I'll briefly show later. So I restored it and I redistributed it with this letter as an open letter. But of course, I put a payload in the JPEG, steganographically encrypted some messages in different versions of this JPEG, because I also wanted to discuss that a JPEG, of course, like isn't only a way to distribute images, but it's also the container of the JPEG, and especially if you steganographically inject content, it actually becomes a unique container discussing the materiality of digital photography. Besides, like, I mean, a lot of me, as an artist, like, I still have to deal with a lot of people discussing paper and discussing prints and like discussing the value of a file, if you can copy it and this kind of bullshit. And in the end, I needed to emphasize the fact that like this image also wasn't mine. I'd just redistributed it. So actually, the only thing that's for sale as an artwork as this is the password to actually access the content I injected into it. And then, of course, you get these questions by institutions, like, how do we show this in a space? So this is, like, working predominantly online. This is the question I get most of the time. Constant, how do we show this in our exhibition? So mostly I just take really stupid analogies, and they work. So here, of course, I use the UV paint, and I just, the text, which is, well, maybe it's an image. But the text that was encrypted in that Jennifer in Paradise image is now painted with UV paint on there. And I would read it as a performance. And then, of course, because I wanted to sell the passwords, I wanted the access to be the commodity, right? So if you're like within art, you're always thinking about a commodity. People want to own something. They want to have like a cultural gesture, which they can own, basically. And then, as an artist, you're entitled to do dramatic gestures, or at least I feel like I was entitled to do dramatic gestures. And to close down the access to the encrypted contents, I had to destroy. Anyway, I don't advise you doing that at home because apparently it's poisonous or whatever. So this basically meant that the people. That the people that wanted access to that content needed to or buy a new UV light, or they needed to buy the password to the file. The cool thing is that John, after a while, did respond. Because it was the Wall Street Journal started to write about it. And the Wall Street Journal, he did find worthy to reply, not my, of course, my skanky little emails writing the big developer. But anyway, no, but he did reply, and he was actually super generous, and he was saying, like, you should have asked me, but he gave a lot of info on, like, which scanner he scanned that first image on, and, like, he went to app, but he also said, like, that he distributed it to other people under a strict non-disclosure agreement, which I'll prove to you later that that's not true. Anyway, but I pointed out what is funny, which is it says it's one of the first images to be Photoshopped. I guess that is a word now. So I'm really happy that I actually have an email to prove the moment when the guy that made up Photoshop figures out that Photoshopping had become a verb. Anyway, and also, like, he used 24-bit color image. So I don't know any of you ever using 24-bit color images. I don't, but maybe you do. But the cool thing also that he needed to transport the image on separate floppy disks to save the red, green, and blue channels, which I also thought was quite remarkable. Anyway, of course, like, this image is really important because it was one of the first digital images at that time for people to use manipulating Photoshop, because it's 1988, so there's no web, there's no digital image distribution or wide availability of it, no digital cameras, so they needed to find that as a source. So this is
I'm going to open up.
This is the demo, actually, where I got it from.
This is a tourist picture I took of my wife when we were on a vacation in Tahiti. So this is from Bora Bora. And I used this image for doing a lot of the demonstrations, including the first demonstrations that I did at Adobe Systems. So I have opened a 24-bit image. We're looking at it on an 8-bit display, but you can still manipulate the 24-bit image. So I'm gonna start by cloning Jennifer. So I'm gonna start by just...
Okay, I'm just gonna mute John Knoll for a bit because it's super interesting, but you can watch the video later. The thing is that, of course, he's cloning his wife. He asked her to marry her the very next day after this picture. I'm just saying he's confirming a very age-old cultural stigma of a man objectifying the female body. And I thought this was really... I mean, the fact that he's cloning his wife and showing that as a tool to his potential customers... Seriously, what the fuck? Why didn't he use a bike or a turtle or something?
Copy. Paste. And now I have a clone.
Anyway, so I've been using that image now because I felt like I made, you know, a new perception of that copy, and I've been using that into different works where I'm just rotating it through all the different Photoshop filters that are available. So you get these kind of images, and you get like these little presentations where I like liquefy Jennifer all over the place and I glitter out, you know, and like there's all these like images, because of course, like, I'm turning this image into a ubiquitous kind of image that's everywhere, so I want to take it out of the idea that it's not visible everywhere. But the cool thing is that finally then, actually, John responded again, and that was in The Guardian, and the cool thing is that where before it was under a so-called non-disclosure agreement, with, actually, my lawyer told me that it's an implicit license he gave because he gave it to other people. Anyway, but the cool thing is that he gave, actually, the real image to The Guardian. So now everybody has access to that first actual image. So I find, like, I still pride myself in, like, kind of tricking him into releasing that first image, where it was first, like, a personal image, and now actually justified to him that the world had a right to see that very first image and to read that very first image as an important image in photographic world history. So I'm quite happy that this is now available for everyone to fuck with. Yeah, so this is Jennifer now, or like about 3 years ago. She's, yeah, this is her. I don't have anything to say about this. And also the nice thing is, also I did want to like ask them to, it's 15 minutes, thank you. I also wanted to, this means I have to hurry up. I actually wanted to take them back to Bora Bora on like a holiday and retake that picture, right? So, and then they perceived it weirdly enough as an indecent proposal. They said like, oh no, that's not okay. And then I thought like, oh, maybe they are prudes because she's like half naked in the picture and maybe she thought I would want to see her naked again. Which I never like, I thought of later. Anyway, but now if you Google her, you get like the first response, or like the first result is my letter to her, which is still very nice, so I hope she read it by now. But to be honest, I only conversed with her husband, and she never replied, which I also think is a bit weird. Yeah, so that. As an artist, I think I'm in the business of turning this into like a more intricate version of this and then calling it art. So I was invited to do an exhibition about clowns, and I gave this press image, and this is actually an artist, Marina Abramovic, that maybe somebody would know, and it's Klaus Biesenbach, who's like some kind of curator, and here's them with more curators, and here's Ai Weiwei with the naked children, which is awkward. No, it's not, it's a joke, sorry. Okay, I just have to catch my breath. So this is weird, right? Like now on Instagram, like Instagram is actually starting to influence like how the art world works. So you would see an artist, you would see the amount of followers, this is a collector, for example, and you would see or read a certain relevance. Like if they have a certain amount of followers, you would think like, okay, that kind of quantitative validation, or like this quantified social validation, might suggest a kind of access to like a social capital, so it means that they're more relevant as a collector or as an artist. And like you would get these collectors that are posing in front of their artworks to generate more relevance for their artworks. And in the end, I was thinking, if that relevance actually starts to, if that social capital, that quantification of social capital actually starts to represent actual capital, like in the art world, but in a lot of other places, then why not buy that capital? And of course, like if you just do a simple search online, you can buy Facebook followers, Instagram followers, everywhere. So, and then I started to research these followers, and these followers were all automated, right? Like this was their content, this were the pictures they're posting. So you would get these like kind of automated pictures where it says, this has the hashtag Instadroid, but weirdly cropped off heads in the image. This also reminiscence with weirdly cropped off heads in the image. And of course, like this means it's just an automatically cropped image because of the, at that time, dominant square format of Instagram pictures. So tags for likes with another few heads missing. Marathon, I never knew you could do a marathon with a snowboard, but whatever. So this is all like generated, right? So, and then you even have the bios. The bios are ripped from other people and then manipulated. So maybe a lot of you people would know this already, but I thought it was really like genuinely awesome poetry, or found poetry, where this is Jonalan, and Jonalan says, smiley, I'll prove to the world that I would ecom some hin imporant to thy ned someday. So I think that's, and Darset says, I love so much us to neighbor. And anyway, I'll skip this. Or simple, pretty, paid. This is also weird. Gondar is a mechanical engineer, 29 years old, graduated from ITM in 2007. I think the original bio read MIT, but I'm not sure. And this is one of my favorites where it says, Mina is Roxy, I like it be fancy. Fort Vio Hort Poems Blogger Web Editing. Anyway, so this is another artist, maybe you know him, Jeff Koons. He was also fresh on Instagram. And you know what I did? I thought, like, if I can buy these followers, you know, if I can find Jeff Koons, why not actually inject some capital into these people and inject some social capital, and I decided to buy 2.5 million Instagram followers because I had a budget from some institution, and I donated these followers to all these artists, right? Because if these artists want to kind of compare lengths of their dicks to like follower numbers, then why not make them all as equal? So thank you. So Jeff Koons had 100,000 followers. Jerry Saltz, who's a critic, also got 100,000 followers. Klaus Biesenbach got 100,000 followers, motherfucker. Richard Prince got 100,000 followers. This Murakami got 100,000 followers. Jonas Lund, a friend of mine, got 100,000 followers. All these people got 100,000 followers, exactly, so they were equal to each other. So basically, I became the Lenin of social media, right? Injecting capital and making people equal is what I do. So this is, but the weird thing was that the New York Times called me, and I'm like, holy fuck, New York Times is calling me. It's on the phone, on this shitty little free phone, or fair phone. Yeah. Like on the, exactly, fair phone. There's New York Times, right? So I'm thinking, okay, this is relevant. I explained them everything, and she keeps asking me, I'm hurrying up. She's asking me, like, yeah, but, like, do you know other people that are selling artwork through Instagram? And, like, did you make money through Instagram? And I'm like, that's, like, what I'm criticizing. Like, this is not what the work is about. Like, I'm not actually telling you, like, maybe somebody once bought a work of mine through Instagram, but that's, like, I'm saying, like, this validation system of you thinking an artwork is important is corrupt. It's vulnerable, it's a system that's fucked, and it's a commercial system that we're buying into, and you shouldn't believe it. So the funny thing was that in this article, she quoted Simon de Puy as an auctioneer, and she quoted his follower number to mention how important he was. But I bought that guy, I bought that motherfucker, like, how many followers? 25,000 followers, so why the fuck did the New York Times quote, you know, that actual number to inject, like, mention some kind of relevance for that auctioneer. The same with Ai Weiwei. They also quoted, like, how many followers they had. Like, I own these followers. Anyway, so we're in a world that these kind of images, this is the most liked image, that this is going to be our culture. That this is going to be the most relevant image because this is the most liked. And that's a shitty place to be. You know, we need to have other tools to talk about the value of images, to talk about our culture and not get trapped into these stigmas. So as an artist, we need other tools to just make, you know, reverse thumbs. We need another way to reflect on that landscape. So then you have, I'm not going to explain technically, but you, yeah, so Friend Bomber, Mass Planner, all these little things, and I got information because I was asked for the Sheeran, Kunsthalle Frankfurt, to do another project, and they gave me some money. And Sheeran, Frankfurt, is based in Hessen, and Hessen delivered the soldiers to fight the first American Revolution. So I thought it would be more than fitting to bring them back to life and fight this American Revolution. So I took all the names from the actual Hessian soldiers that fought in the United States, were paid by the British, and actually with that money, the very first contemporary art museum was funded, the Friedrichianum. Anyway, 1780, all these names I got through the wonderful Landesgeschichte information system, but also the professor that helped me. So these are all the accounts that I made active. But the weird thing was that all these accounts, like a lot of these were created in Pakistan also, like they were actually manually crafted also, like I had automated ones, but I also tried to disguise, like have the manually crafted ones. And then these pictures showed up and I actually had to explain them, like the Hessian soldiers were white and like I shouldn't have like non-white passport pictures on there. And then when I was typing this in Skype, weirdly enough, all these people use Skype, which I thought was very weird, knowing what we know. But anyway, it felt so weird to ask that and say, like, could you please use white images, that I stopped asking that. So if somebody talks to me about, like, the conceptual error, why the artificial army isn't all white, it's because I don't give a fuck anymore, and I don't want to ask somebody in Pakistan to only use white images, because it's fucked. Anyway, so of course, because it's, thank you, because it's also, of course, like, it's very weird that we're using this kind of like system where it's like a lot of this kind of artificial capital, this artificial social capital is crafted in lower wage countries. And we're actually supporting a system by buying these followers and buying this kind of black hat SEO shit with like having very large groups of people crafting this kind of these kind of accounts. And anyway, I think there's like a kind of messy thing. But the nice thing about like using army as an analogy is that it brought me onto BBC News. And this is also really funny because I think this is again like the value of, I could have said like I made a, like a large collection of phone verified accounts. But I think by saying like I made a fake army or I made an army got me on the news. And then the funny thing is that actually, although it's been on the news and in The Guardian again, the nice thing is over half of the army is still alive. So they're still out there. I'm still distributing likes. I'm still using that. If you would want to help me, please give me, if you have like spare Facebook accounts, which I hope you don't. If you do, fuck Facebook, get the fuck out of there. But also, if you do have them, give them to me and please accept the friends of like another 1,000 soldiers and the next few 1,000 soldiers that I'm gonna make. And let's create some social noise. Let's create some social noise of like, and fight this kind of weird artificial system of like quality validation through through this kind of artificial social measurement system. So yeah, like, fuck Facebook. Anyway, I'll just play with a short piece of, is that a zero or do I have like a few more minutes left? Okay, so I'll play a brief part of my video with like my call to war, let's say. This is not a part of the video.
Hi, and welcome to our tutorial. In this video, we will show you how to create identities through the Quick Start Wizard.
Thank you very much. So yeah, if there's questions, I would just like to say at the end of the project, I'll also release like of course like the cool little graphs that you see like when it hit the BBC, how many profiles were deleted by Facebook, and how, and like. And you'll see like how many little like attacks sparked, which how many deletions and these kind of things. But again, like if you could help me to have these fake identities infiltrate the real world with the real identities and let them mash up together, I would be very grateful for this project.
Well, I would also like to boost up my Instagram, my Twitter, my Facebook too.
Oh, you want more followers?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Please, 10,000.
I get that a lot.
Are we not friends? 100,000. Thank you so much for the super interesting talk. I think we have time for two questions. Or even one question from...
Oh, there's a big no on
no.
that.
No. So, if there's any questions, then I think we can do that outside of the talk right now. Thank you very much.
Thank you.